we're talking historical matters now, but not sport, music. What were you doing 20 years ago? What's that, 1992?
20 years ago, I would have been 22.
What were you doing?
When I was 22, I was, had I moved to Preston? Yes, I was working in Preston at the Lancashire Evening Post.
Marvellous.
Yeah, had my Suzuki Swift.
Did you?
Thought I was God's gift.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you probably were.
Yeah. Well, no, probably not.
It's the 20th anniversary of the release of a debut.
What were you doing?
I was working for Radio 4, I think, in London.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was fun. We were young.
Well, I know.
And broke. It's the 20th anniversary of the release of a debut album from a young band from Blackwood. The Manic Street Preachers released Generation Tourists, Terrorists, on this day in 1992. Here's a whistle-stop tour of the album. Let's talk to the music critic for The Independent and the author Simon Price, who's with us, and we're also joined by James McLaren from the BBC Wales music website. Gentlemen, morning both. Simon, what were you doing 20 years ago?
I was writing for The Melody Maker and waiting for something exciting to come along, and just my luck, the Manx did come along.
What did you make of it?
Well, you know, to set the scene, in the early 90s, you've got to understand that the Manx were the most exciting band in Britain, bar none. You know, these four politicised Welsh glam punks, you know, covered in eyeliner and spray paint and offending and insulting anyone and everyone and playing these kind of chaotic, thrilling and often violent gigs. So I've got to say, for me, it was actually a real disappointment that the first album, for me, failed to capture that excitement.
Because their debut album was originally destined also to be their last, wasn't it? Just explain that.
It's the kind of adorably ludicrous thing they used to say back then, that they promised to make one double album, sell a million copies, headline Wembley Stadium, then split up.
It didn't quite happen that way, did it?
It didn't. No.
James, what were you doing 20 years ago?
I was at school, I was 13, getting into sort of all the American sort of grunge rock thing, and then here the Manics, they're British, they look like kind of Motley Crue stroke Guns N' Roses, but then they throw in Nietzsche and Camus, and you think, what on earth are these people? Who are they? Alien Welsh kids. Hmm.
Simon, you reviewed the album for Melody Maker. How did you rate it at the time? Can you remember what you wrote? You're not embarrassed by what you wrote then?
Yeah, I called it a damaged diamond at the time, and you know, Nicky Wire agreed with that, and Richie Edwards later admitted everybody knows the first album would have been better if we'd left out all the, well, I'm not going to say the word, but you get the idea. I've written a blog for the BBC Wales music site, which I think you'll be talking about shortly.
Yeah.
It's up there now if people want to read it, in which I've argued that, in retrospect, what the Manics should have done was made one kind of short, sharp, furious, incendiary punk rock album and saved the more kind of sophisticated stuff for later. But instead, what they did with Generation Terrorist, they made a very sort of slick commercial heavy metal record, when ironically that stuff wasn't actually commercial anymore. They delivered essentially a left-wing Bon Jovi album at the exact moment where what people wanted was a Nirvana album.
I kind of disagree a little bit with Simon. I mean, his feature on the site is fantastic, but for me, because it is sort of overlong, overblown, slightly ridiculous, if you've got something perfect, it almost makes it less perfect. If you've got something that has its downsides, it's that sort of slightly sort of, as you say, damaged diamond. So for me, I have a lot of affection for that.
Mm. Simon, what about the decision for the sound and for that first album? Whose would that have been? Because I'm guessing it wouldn't have been the Manics' choice to do what they did.
No, I've got to say, I think you're probably wrong there. I think it was a very conscious decision by them, because they grew up in the kind of South Wales culture of heavy metal, and they always had more respect for bands like Guns N' Roses than for kind of tinny little indie schmindy bands. And they wanted it to sound big and expensive, and they wanted to be a kind of global force to be reckoned with. But unfortunately, they chose exactly the wrong moment for that, because the tide was turning against that kind of slick commercial sound.
I mean, they'd signed to Sony and released the album. I mean, there is an irony there, isn't there, James?
There's a huge
corporate global record company. I mean, everything the Manics kind of hated, you'd have thought.
No, but they were totally unashamed. They wanted to be successful. The idea in the kind of, as Simon said, the indie schmindy mentality, which is, oh, I don't want to sell any records because then I'd be selling out, and, you know, all this kind of thing, slightly punk rock attitude, wasn't them at all. They wanted to sell loads of records, and they went out of their way to be as commercial as possible. Selling to Sony, signing to Sony was part of the plan.
And what do you make of that, Simon?
I think he's right, and in the long run, it paid off, because it meant that, you know, Sony gave them the backing and had the kind of faith in them to persevere and eventually become the great band they always wanted to. It's just that at the time, their ambition, and, you know, again, this is a really likeable and adorable thing, but their ambition overreached their actual ability. The album does contain some of their greatest songs, Motorcycle Emptiness, we just heard there, which is, you know, a heartbreakingly beautiful 6-minute epic about what consumerism does to the human soul, and you've got things like Little Baby Nothing about the sex industry's exploitation of women, which and this is a masterstroke, having a duet with the world's most infamous porn star, Tracy Lords. But just for me, there are too many kind of dull soft metal songs about the international banking system.
we're celebrating this 20th anniversary today, but I mean, James, I mean, they were notorious on the music scene for several years before releasing the album. And James, just take us back to the mid 80s and I guess their punk roots.
Well, they formed, I mean, Simon can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but they formed in the late 80s. Of Swansea University was where I think Nicky was. Their early shows were fairly sort of shambolic and chaotic and wonderful, I'm sure, if you were there. I was far too young. I was practically in shorts. What really strikes me is that our kind of image of them, that Manic Millennium 1999 in sort of slacks and smart shirts, was only 7 years after Generation Terrorists. But from the late 80s through to about 1994, they were wearing, you know, combats and spray paints and tight trousers, and it was all very sloganeering. And then they became very, very sort of staid when they became successful. And I have a lot of affection for this early period.
What about you, Simon? Do you just talk us through that, almost that transformation?
Yeah, I think James is right. They became a completely different band after 1996. And a lot of their recent material has been about exactly that problem, that you can't recapture that youthful anger when you're older. But they do seem to switch back and forth. You know, they'll make a kind of angry, political, almost punk rock record. Then they'll change their minds and make a very mainstream, slick, radio-friendly one. And I think that's been the story of their entire career, just switching back and forth between those two extremes.
Simon, before Christmas, the band played all 38 of their singles in that mammoth gig at the O2 Arena. What was that like?
It was fantastic, and I think everybody was willing them on, because they'd be the first to admit that not all of those 38 singles actually stand the test of time. And if they were choosing a real best of, a lot of those songs wouldn't have made it. But it was this kind of task, almost a challenge they set themselves, right, we're going to do this. And the audience were with them all the way. And it lifted the weaker songs of their set and made it all just really fly, I think.
And what about the album, that first album, Generation Terrorists, 20 years on? You know, how does that stand up now?
I listened to it just the other day, start to finish, and at the time, I remember, it just seemed interminable, you know, 18 songs, because people didn't make albums that long in those days. These days, it's par for the course, it really is, and it almost seems to fly by. And I think, you know, I do hit the skip button on a few tracks, definitely. But the moments, you know, when it's good, it's really good, let's say that.
I mean, obviously, this debut album was just the first chapter in a long Manic story that we all know, Simon.
Yeah, and I think the fact that it failed, you know, the first album, is actually the best thing about it. It didn't fail completely. It went gold. It sold a respectable 300,000. But you know, it did get them off the hook. It got them off the hook of that promise to split up, and it gave them the excuse, or you might say the motivation, to carry on and to actually get better.
James, tell us a bit about what's happening at the BBC Wales Music website then, 20 years on.
We have such a wealth of material. Very grateful for Simon for contributing, as he ever does with when we do Manic stuff. But we also have brand new interviews with Steve Brown, the producer. We actually caught up with Tracy Lords. She emailed us from LA, and so that's an amazing coup to get her. Fantastic. Other sort of engineers who worked on the record, Dave Eringer, who's the fifth Manic, as it were. Our own Adam Walton has put his own spin on the record. Great old photos, clips. There's such a wealth of stuff you can look at.
Gentlemen, good to see you both. Let's play out with one of the standout singles from that first album. This is Motorcycle Emptiness. Our thanks this morning to Simon Price and also to James McLaren. Much more on the BBC website, bbc.co.uk/Wales Music.